What's going on, everybody? I'm Patrick from Powlax, and this video is an excerpt from our Man Down Defensive video where we're going to be talking about the five-man rotation.
Before we get started, make sure to check out the brand new Powlax and PowlaxMasterCoach.com, where you can download and print the playbook PDFs that accompany over 50 Powlax videos by becoming a member and supporting this channel. The new site has been streamlined to make navigating, watching, supporting, and downloading the Powlax content simple and straightforward. We also broadened our membership categories to allow annual and program-wide memberships. Also, make sure to check out the Powlax Teespring store, where you can get Powlax hoodies, t-shirts, tank tops, mugs, even phone cases, and you can customize them to fit your team's colorway. Finally, make sure to like, subscribe, and follow Powlax on all these social media sites. Now, let's get back to the video.
The first foundation of our five-man rotation, man-to-man, man-down defense, is the fact that we want to have our players be able to play the ball straight up. We don't want to have them worried about space. If a player on the offensive team has the ball, we want one of our defensive players to be responsible solely for that player. And so everything else is going to cascade behind them to backfill for the remaining five players. Now, once we have that, when the ball moves, a new player will become the ball and everyone else's responsibilities are going to change as the ball swings around the perimeter of the field. Now, the first thing we have to do is understand all of the different positions so that then we can understand how each player is going to move in relation to the offense moving the ball and moving themselves. So the first thing we have is a player is going to have the ball. We've got the ball with M2. That means that the LSM is responsible for M2 and his call is going to be ball. Now, the player who is ball is only responsible for the ball. They have to be able to defend any kind of dodges. They want to have their stick in front. They want to try to knock down passes. All of those things we'll get to in the individual play, but they are responsible for the offensive player who has the ball. Now, to the left and to the right, we have the adjacents, and that's going to be D1 and D3, and they're going to communicate that by saying left or right. Left and right are directly related to the side of the on-ball defenseman. So D3 is going to be right, and D1 is going to be left. Now, the players to the left and to the right are going to be responsible for the offensive players to the left and the right. So D3 is responsible for M3, D1 is responsible for M1, and if those players cut to the middle of the field, they want to stay with those players, right? They are actually responsible for them. The other thing that they are responsible for is filling the skip lanes through to the other players. So D1 is responsible for guarding the skip lane through to A3. And they want to do that by having their sticks up in the passing lanes. Now, D3 is responsible for the skip lane through to A1. Now, the final responsibility that we have is called A2, and it's two for the following reasons. First, it's two passes away, and they are responsible for two separate players. So DM1 and D2 are our twos. And so you could have a right two and a left two, but for the most part, we just communicate that with them saying two. Now, as a two, they are responsible for their man, so D2 is responsible for A1, plus half of A2. That's where the two separate players comes in. DM1 is responsible for A3 and half of A2. Now, as the ball moves, depending on the direction, the players they are responsible for may actually change, or they're actually just going to be only responsible for one rather than two. Now, in the same way that D1 is responsible for M1 if he cuts through, DM1 is responsible for A3 if he cuts through. They'll have to communicate who will take A2 if he cuts to the crease, but they are responsible for defending those players within our set. Now, as the ball swings, each player is going to have to shift their responsibilities according to their relationship to the on-ball defender. So right now, the LSM is ball, D1 is left, D3 is right, DM1 and D2 are twos. But if M1 passes the ball to M3, now D3 becomes the ball, the LSM becomes left, D1 becomes a two, and DM1 remains a two, and then D2 becomes right. Now, when the ball moves again, now D2 is ball. And if D2 is ball, that means that DM1 is now right, defending A2, D3 is now left, defending M3 still. The LSM is now 2, defending M2 and half of M1. D1 is now 2, defending A3 and half of M1. And so as you can see, as the ball swings around the perimeter of the field, all of their responsibilities are going to change.
In this clip, we're going to give a visual representation of the responsibilities and communication that Notre Dame will be going through. As Hopkins sets up their 3-3, the ball is going to move 3 times, from top right to low left. Now, as the ball is up top right, this is ball, left, right, 2, and 2. Now, as the ball moves once, we have a new ball, right, left, 2, and 2. It moves again, ball, left, right, 2, 2. And finally, ball, left, right, 2, 2. Now, as we rewind to when the ball was top right, notice that the short stick is defending the player on the crease. As the ball moves, he moves from being a 2 to a 2 to a left to a ball. And so every time the ball moves, he must recalibrate where he is in relation to the on-ball defender.
Now that we have a basic understanding of the mechanics and the rules that each player has to work with within our 5-man rotation, we're going to talk about a couple of the other tactics and things we're going to see, because obviously an offense isn't just going to pass the ball around the perimeter of the field. Now the first thing we're going to discuss is where we want to put our short stick DM1. For the most part, the short stick is usually placed in this low left or low right corner, because for the most part, that's where the weakest offensive players are, because offensive teams want to put their best shooters and players up top, because that's where they're going to have the best shooting chances. Now, that's not to say that you're going to have weak players down here on man up. Some teams are just loaded, like Virginia was in the past couple years, but it's important to know that if we're going to have a shorty in our 5-man rotation, that's where the majority of collegiate teams put them. Now, the second thing we want to talk about is, how are we going to play players who are moving onto and off of the crease? So we've got a little play that we'll kind of run here that we saw a couple times this summer, and it's basically that M2 is going to get the ball, M3 is going to cut to the crease, A1 is going to come up, and then A2 is going to come up the hash as well. Now, in this scenario, the LSM has ball, D3 has right, and so as M3 cuts to the crease, D3 has to stay with him. So he's got to stay with the cut, which now makes D2 the right. And so as the ball is passed to A1, D2 is going to maintain his matchup with A1, and that's going to push DM1 to be the new right, who's going to have to get over to cover A2 as he moves through there. Now DM1 is going to move to play the ball. D1 is going to come down to be right. D3, who covered the cut to the crease, is going to be a new 2 so that he can look through to the backside as he's covering the cut. The key is, we don't want to have someone who is defending a cut to the crease to then be responsible for any of the adjacents. We want to make sure that he is now responsible for looking to the backside, to the weakest players, where we're not going to give up someone who's right next to the ball because a player is defending a cut to the crease and now has to get back to them. That's more of a zone tendency. Now, after the offense made this motion, they are now into a 3-3, and we're going to discuss how we want to play players who step off of the crease onto the perimeter when they are adjacent to the ball. So we're going to have them run a 4-man wheel. So the ball is going to be passed up to A1, and then these four players, A1, M2, M1, and M3, are going to run a 4-man wheel. So he's going to carry, fade, cut the middle, float. And so the first thing to recognize is that we've got two adjacents who are going to be the LSM and DM1 when the carry is made. Now, on that carry, they are responsible for their specific players unless they are carried away from, because then they're probably going to become a new 2, or there's going to be someone who's going to fill that space from the crease. So in this specific example, as A1 carries, D2 must stay with his man because he's got the ball and he's there, right? The LSM must stay with M2. Now here's where it gets a little bit tricky. Instead of having D3 cover this cut and become the adjacent, we are actually going to have DM1 rotate up to now cover M3. And the reason why is because DM1 is in a place where he is ready to rotate to the next pass back the way he came. And so instead of having D3, who's a 2, become the new right and then pull him away from these backside players. We're actually just going to have DM1 rotate up so that D3 and D1 can now cover M1, A3, and A2 on the backside, because that's the position that they were already in. So the idea here is, instead of having a player come through the defense and out a side, we are just going to maintain the positions that we've already had as the rotation or the motion starts, right? So if it's a pass, we're going to rotate. If it's a carry, we're going to maintain our positions and make sure that we are available to fill the roles that we're already in. And so because A1 carries to the top and DM1 was the right, if M3 pops off of the crease here, DM1 is going to show to it and rotate, which allows D1 and D3 to maintain and stay the twos.
In this clip, we're going to watch Yale run 3 4-man top wheels like the one we just outlined against Penn's 5-man rotation. The thing we really want to notice is, how does Penn play the players who step off of the crease behind the carry, and how do they play players who are cutting to the crease from the two position? The first time through, we're going to focus on how Penn is playing the players who pop off the crease behind the carry. Notice how as the carry begins, the player in the right position sees the player coming off of the crease and rotates up to cover him, telling the two that he is leaving. The ball swings forward and Yale runs the 4-man top wheel the other way. The same thing happens. The player in the left position notices the player coming off the crease between him and the ball carrier. He maintains his position and rotates up to be the new left. The ball swings to top right and then down and then back up, and they run another 4-man top wheel, and this time the exact same thing happens. The player who is floating off the crease behind the carry is met by the original right. Now this time the ball carrier actually sees him rotate up and skips the ball through to the right pipe. They definitely got away with one here. The ball's passed back up to top right, to top center, back to top right. They take a nice shot and the ball is saved. Now we're going to focus on how Penn is playing the players who are cutting to the crease. In the first example, they're going to play it like a true 5-man rotation, where the player in the 2 position is going to stay with the cut and then end up on the opposite side of the field as a 2. In the second and third examples, Penn uses an advanced concept and zones up using the 2s and covering all 3 using more zone principles. But that's not always going to work the way that they want it, depending on the movement of the offense. Even here, you can see that the cut to the crease is actually wide open. Yale just doesn't find it. For the most part, in a true 5-man rotation, any cuts need to be covered to the crease, and then they will reestablish their 2 positions by having the player who defended the cut become a 2, as well as the player who is naturally already a 2.
Now, in the event that there are only 5 perimeter players, we're essentially going to spoke out to any of the offensive players on the perimeter of the field. So here, if M2 has the ball and now he makes 2 passes, say to A2 and then down to A3, we are basically going to have everyone spider in on the backside. So when M2 has the ball, D3 spidered into M3, DM1 is spidered into M3, and they are the 2s because they're covering M3 but also responsible for A3 and A1. Now, as the ball moves to A2, now that's going to pull D1 in and it's going to release D3 out to play A3. When the ball moves again, now the LSM is going to have to get in to cover the crease, because now D2 and DM1 are going to be the right and left. And so now we have another dilemma. Do we want to go play the ball at X? I like to play the ball at X because I think that having a player sit back there and then try and feed the 5v5 up top is something where we're going to give up a bunch of goals. And I also don't like the idea of waiting by the pipes, because that's much more of a zone principle. For instance, if in this set we have D3 sit here on the pipe when A3 gets the ball, and now A3 rounds this corner, now DM1, who was supposed to be the right, is now ball for some reason, because we didn't maintain the ideas of how we're playing. Like, if you don't want to play the ball at X, I say don't go and play in a man-to-man type of formation, because unless you're going to go into some kind of zone when the ball's at X, you're not going to be using the same rules when the ball is at X. And so I like the idea of playing at X if you're going to use your 5-man rotation, or using some other kind of zone to backfill your 5-man. Now we're going to go through a bunch of examples of some collegiate teams using their 5-man rotation.
In this clip, we're going to watch Duke's 5-man rotation versus Richmond, and we're going to focus on 2 parts. First is how one of our 2s needs to get down to the backside pipe whenever the ball hits one of the low corners. Next, we're going to talk about how defending cuts as the two will oftentimes bring you into the crease, but if the ball continues to swing, you're going to stay in your section of the field because you're in to cover as the two, but as the ball moves, you become a left or a right. As we begin this clip, notice how this player here is going to get down to the backside pipe player once the ball moves to the low corner. As the ball swings through X, this player becomes the backside pipe 2. And now as the ball swings up and they run their motion, the 2s stay the same, but the players they're defending switches. As the ball is thrown back here, notice that this player is moving down to the backside pipe because there might be another pass down to the low right corner. This pass never comes, which opens up the top left shooter. The ball is skipped through to a nice step down, but the key here is we'd rather give up this step down than have a pass go down and through to the back pipe. This time through, we're going to focus on how Duke covers this cut to show how, even if you are defending a cut to the crease, you should defend the cut, but if the ball moves and that makes you a right or a left, you are no longer responsible for that cut, and you need to become a right or the left. As the ball is passed from top left to side left, notice that these are the twos and the cut starts. As the player gets to the crease, the ball moves from side left to side right, which now makes this player the left, so he now does not have responsibility of covering the player who just moved to the crease. This player is now a two, and he is responsible for covering the cut to the crease, but then as the ball moves from side right to top right, he now becomes the left and can vacate his responsibility covering this cut because he is now the new left. In this clip of Virginia's man up versus UNC's five-man rotation, you're going to notice that Virginia is going to run an initial motion to set up their 3-3. Instead of having this pole cover the cut to the crease, they're just going to pass him off and allow the short stick to move upfield to cover the crease because that's where UNC would have wanted the short stick to start with. Once that happens, Virginia swings the ball and they're actually going to attack this short stick. So once the ball hits side right, it moves up top right to top center. And as the short stick moves in to cover the crease as a two, the player top center throws a no-look pass through to bottom right, and the goalie makes a tremendous save. The key here is that if you want your players to start in a specific position before moving into the five-man rotation, you can have them do it. They just need to know what's going on. In this clip of Loyola's man-up offense versus Syracuse's five-man rotation, we're going to show two adaptations that Syracuse uses. First, Syracuse uses a zone principle by having one player play two. Now, this doesn't seem like a bad thing because Loyola's not attacking the goal yet, but as all the players are rotating, if one player decides to play two, that's going to change the responsibilities of everyone else around him. Notice how on this pass, this player's left, this player's right, these are the two twos, and as he decides to play two, the left maintains his responsibility as the left, but instead of playing this player, he now has to rotate up to this player. This isn't a very big deal here, but if Loyola was attacking the goal, this could have dire consequences because everyone's responsibility would have to shift because one player tried to play two. Now, as the ball swings to the left side of the field, through X and then back, you'll notice that Syracuse goes into a house zone until the motion is finished. Then, as Loyola continues to play, they resume their five-man rotation. Now, right here, you're going to see that the short stick actually gets pulled too far inside as the ball hits the right side of the field. Then, as it reverses back, the long stick and the short stick actually switch, which puts the short stick at the low left position rather than top left. This isn't necessarily a bad thing, but each position has to understand their new role based on the new position that they're in. Here, the long stick tries to play the player who is side left and top left, and the short stick plays the player on the crease and doesn't get back to the player who is bottom left. This leaves the bottom left player open, the ball is skipped through to him, and Loyola scores. In this section, we're going to outline what players should be cognizant of and try to do when they're in each position in the man-to-man, man-down defensive set. First, we're going to talk about the ball, then we'll talk about adjacents, and then we'll talk about the twos. When a player is playing the ball, we want to make sure that they approach to the head of the offensive player's stick, which is usually taken away topside. As we approach, we want to break down in an athletic stance, making sure that if the player decides to dodge or get past us, that we can push them off of their line and keep them out of the middle of the field. Next, we want to make sure that we break down at the edge of dangerous space and that we don't overextend because we're going to need to get to another responsibility quickly after we play the ball. Next, if there is a possibility of getting in the hands of the offensive player, we definitely want to throw our check out to the hands. Finally, after the ball is thrown, we want to assume the left or right positions with our sticks up and to the inside. If you're in an adjacent position, the first thing you must do is make sure that you can see your man and the ball. I like to call this V to C, where you stick your arms out pointing towards your man and then towards the ball. This V V of your arms means that you can see both your man and the ball. Next, we want to make sure that we have our sticks up in the passing lanes and we're deterring the passes to the twos. If your player decides to cut, we want to make sure that we stay with the cut through the crease and we'll end up as a two on the backside. In the event that the ball carrier moves and a new player comes between us and the ball carrier, we want to rotate up to that player. Finally, in the event that the ball carrier looks like they're going to pass to our player, we want to anticipate the pass and arrive with the ball. When we are defending in the two position, the first thing we want to do is make sure that we are in a stance that allows us to see both of the players that we are defending. Then we want to locate both of those players. Once we locate both of those players, we want to shade towards the more dangerous player, which usually means that that player is in on the crease. If they are both on the perimeter of the field, we want to make sure that we split both of them evenly. Next, we want to make sure that if our man cuts to the crease, we are going to follow them on the cut and we are going to leave the farthest pass open. Finally, we want to make sure that we announce pops off the crease so that if you're defending a player and they pop off the crease to an adjacent position, we need to alert the adjacent defender and make sure that they know to rotate up to that player. If we are on the man down defense and we are being used as a personnel lock off, we are going to face guard the player who we are playing. That means that we are going to basically put our face in the other player's face and we are not going to worry about anything except for that player. When you face guard, you allow the offensive player to move, but you are right on them the entire time and you never look away from them or let them get away from you. In the event that you are locking off a specific location on the field, you need to make sure that you communicate and announce the players who are leaving your zone so that the other zones know to pick up the player who is leaving your zone. They are going to become someone else's responsibility, but you have the responsibility of letting them know that they're coming. Finally, if somebody cuts into your space, you must make sure that you shift to defend them and announce that you have covered them so that the player in the zone that they came from can release to cover the rest of their zone.
Thanks for taking the time to watch this video. I hope that you enjoyed it. Definitely let me know what you guys thought down in the comment section. I hope that after watching this, you feel more competent about how you understand man down defense and feel that you can make the best decision for your team. Make sure to check out the brand new PowLaxMasterCoach.com where you can now watch, support, and download all of the PowLax content. We're kind of getting away from the Patreon third-party stuff. I built an entire website dedicated to all of the PowLax content that you can now actually support for $5 a month and download all of the content in a much easier to navigate and view way. So definitely check out PowLaxMasterCoach.com. Also, if you'd like to support the channel, check out the PowLax Teespring store where you can buy a bunch of PowLax merch and show your support in your local community. Finally, make sure to follow PowLax on all types of social media. We've got a TikTok, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, LinkedIn. We like to post at least once a day, maybe twice. Sometimes we kind of miss a day here or there either way. But so make sure to follow us on all of social media to stay involved. And I hope you guys enjoyed the video. Have a good one. I'll see you guys in the next one.